Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you all for coming to tonight's event. It's really great to see all of you. I'm Joyce Moy, the Executive Director of the Asian American Asian Research Institute, known as AAARI, here at the City University of New York. We are an institute that works with all of the campuses in the CUNY system in the five boroughs. Our mission is to support and facilitate research as well as to do original research on issues that concern Asian American communities and Asia itself. I'm really pleased to be able to bring to you a program tonight along with many of the faculty members that you see here from Hunter and from Queens College. They have a really great program for you tonight. Two of our authors are going to talk about their books, and these publications are going to be made available to you. The Asian American Asian Research Institute has had the great pleasure of having visiting professors as Thomas Tam scholars. Thomas Tam was the founder of AAARI, and Thomas Tam was dedicated to promoting and advancing the cause of Asian American studies and Asian studies throughout CUNY. So I have the pleasure of introducing several of the scholars who have come to visit with us, including this year's scholars. There is Vivian Louie, who was our scholar last year, and she was posted at Hunter. We have also Prima Curian, who is this year's visiting scholar from Syracuse. And we have the infamous Russell Leong, who was also a visiting scholar. And it appears that he likes CUNY because he's been back for a couple of years now. He is also the editor of a new publication that just came out last year. And we have our second edition out this year called the CUNY Forum. And you're going to find some really good, interesting pieces in here. I would encourage you to pick a copy up. It's only $10, and I am shamelessly plugging it. And you're going to see pieces from our faculty, faculty from around the world, and faculty from around the United States. Again, some very interesting pieces. I really do hope that you pick it up and support it. Those of you that see pieces that might be helpful to you in terms of your classes and teaching and so on, talk to us so we can see how we can collaborate and make this material available to you. So without further ado, I have this easy job of turning the podium over to Russell Leong, who's going to introduce our next speakers and the program for the rest of the evening. Thank you all.
Thanks, Joyce. Thanks for coming. I know you have many choices on a beautiful Friday day and an evening, but you made the right choice. So thank you for coming. Actually, it's today's program is called the Mapping Seminar, and this mapping seminar is comprised of a number of prominent scholars and our CEO and muckraker, writer, filmmaker, Professor Peter Kwong, distinguished professor at Hunter College. He will actually be leading the discussion and introducing the folks on the program. I'd like to point out that there's a number of also very instrumental key people in our mapping group. Professor Kyo Lee, John Jay, stand up. Hey there. Margaret Chin, Professor Margaret Chin, Hunter, thank you. And John Chin, another infamous guy. Okay, John, stand up. Hunter College as well. Did I leave anyone out? Oh, Vivian, you were introduced, but you could stand, but you didn't stand up. Please stand up. Vivian Louie, thank you. And, oh yeah, okay. I thought you were going to introduce him. That's part of the program. So let me turn this over. Now, the jobs get easier and easier. I'm going to turn this over to Professor Peter Kwong. Peter.
Thanks for coming. Today, this is our first public event for this mapping seminar of Asian Americans in New York. And this is an organization that we formed a year ago. Basically, the background is this, that Asians are the fastest growing population in New York City. That in fact, I just talked to the city census bureau, Joe Salvo. He talked about the fact that the population in New York City has gone through very, very dramatic changes. One of the changes that white Americans' population is levering off. African Americans actually are declining. That Latinos, some Latinos are increasing dramatically.
Group
that is increasing in natural numbers as well as in immigration of Asian Americans. And you know, years ago, we talk about Asians as a insignificant minorities, but now we are no longer 8%. In New York City, it's actually 13%. So the increase in numbers and the demographic changes are making significant impact on all kinds of communities. So for instance, you find new Korean, Bangladeshi, Chinese community spreading all over the place. Brooklyn, for instance, every part of Brooklyn now has some concentration of Chinese Americans.
So the problem is that we, academic groups, nonprofits that provide services to the Asian American population, as well as government agencies, their understanding, their knowledge is very, very much behind, right? For us, for instance, even though Asian American studies is existing in many campuses, but most of our energy are expended in teaching, right? So individually, we do some research, but as a group, there's so much information we don't know and lagging behind. So our mapping seminar's attempt is basically to say, look, you're doing research, somebody else is doing research, we don't communicate. Why don't we do a mapping of all the different research that people are doing? So a lot of times I don't know who somebody is doing in Queens or Columbia. Asian American Federation, they have come out, published different kind of reports. And all the other groups had, because of their own needs, coming up with reports. But those reports not necessarily reaching us, right? And they don't know what we're doing either. So the mapping seminar is trying to establish somehow as a center where these different groups could somehow have some kind of connections, communication, so we could find out who's doing what. And using what we know, try to improve our research. At the same time, to find out what are some of the areas we really need to know, but we don't know. And that will be driving our research agenda. And finally, it is the point that ultimately, nonprofit groups, government agencies try to serve Asian American community, that they need information that we as an academic institution has a responsibility to devise our research agenda to help them, right? So that's the effort that we just barely beginning, and we're finding a lot of interest. New York is big. Having meetings and getting people together is extremely difficult. So this is the beginning process we're trying to generate, make ourselves known, make other people connected with us. We go reaching out to them. And so let's see, 5-10 years from now, that we will have a much better understanding and catching up with the growth of the Asian American community. So this is basically this group is about. Now, I have the distinct honor to introduce three of my most favorite individuals, that they are all related in the academic field, but they all have something very unique, very strong sense of social justice. They're all different, doing different research, but they are They are on the ground. They are really not like the normal academics who Ivy Tower, stay in the library. These people are really working on the grassroots, doing field research, and connecting with the community organization, helping out, and all that. So anyway, without much ado, all three of them have something to present today. And because all three of them have their own work that just been recently published. The first individual is Professor Ken Guest, one of my favorite individual because he was my student. And whatever is wrong with him has nothing to do with me. But I'm very proud of... but anyway, his book is called Cultural Anthropology, A Toolbox for Global Age, it's published by H.H. Norton. Now, in this book, he's trying to basically say, in the field of anthropology, there are a lot of outdated perception, outdated approach to understanding cultural, to understanding ethnic communities. And this is a book trying to help us to try to bring into the current global age. And also, he is one of those persons who would like to challenge the stuffiness of the old approach of the anthropology, that is to introduce the whole concept of power, right? That in the old days, anthropology is somehow is almost like flat mapping and does not talk very much about power. And he's trying to encourage people to think in terms of that. Now, he is. This is a book most of academics don't publish because this is a money making book. This is a book. This is what you call. Teacher's guide, right? Textbooks, and H.H. Norton published these very profitable books that everybody has to teaching anthropology, culture, and has to buy. So, anyway, so he's in the right market. But on the other hand, he's well deserved because he has spent the last 20 years doing field research, particularly in the Chinese American community, and specifically dealing with Fujianese community, something that he and I share. His first book is called God in Chinatown, Religion, and my eyes is not... I didn't bring my right glasses. Survival in New York in Evolving Immigrant Communities. It's a book that so many people refer to because it's about Chinese religious institutions. He has spent years talking to congregations, parishioners, all these different people, and even get into individual families, and it's extensive detailed studies. And so even though he's talking about religion, you actually learn a great deal about Chinese immigrant community from a different angle. And and so a lot of people will ask me, Peter, have you read this book? I say, yes. I corrected some of the manuscript in this. But anyway. So he's a associate professor at Baruch. He's a graduate of Columbia University Asian Studies, and he went to Union Seminary, Theological Seminary for a master's degree and got his PhD in CUNY Graduate Center, right? So that's Ken. Tarry Hum. Another favorite person of mine, grew up in Sunset Park. His specialization is urban economics, urban planning, immigration, Asian American communities, and particularly economic developments of immigrant communities. She received her master's degree from MIT. urban planning, and she got her PhD at UCLA Urban Planning Department. Now, her work is the work that she is the book she's publishing now. It's It's called "Making of a Global Immigrant Neighborhood." It's a history of evolution of Sunset Park, right? And as you probably know, most research has been done on Manhattan Chinatown, and some done on Flushing, but very, very few works done on Sunset Park. This is a really, and Sunset Park in many, many ways, very different from Chinatown, very much different from Flushing, and that it's unique, and it's new community in so many ways, that she was able to do research on that community, inform us how different and how it's how is revolving to, and her main interest also about the working poor, about the multiracial environment, and in that sense she's constantly thinking in terms of ways that could help the people who are less fortunate, who are economically disadvantaged. And so one of her very, very important contribution is understanding Chinese banks, right? So one of the things that my scholar friends always say, oh, you guys got all these banks, you know, that Chinese always have money to do whatever is going on. And of course that Tarry made it very, very clear. What kind of things these Chinese banks really do? In some ways is they have, they have direct access to the community for some group of people. On the other hand, they are just as indifferent, even less so, contributing to the economic conditions of the Chinese population. Anyway, so she has been a consultant on so many different community development projects that they all dealing with minorities, disadvantaged communities, and her efforts is really, as an urban planner, oftentimes people think, urban planners, you plan, don't do very much, and a lot of times urban planners really don't have any leverage, so basically they work in urban planning, the boss tell you what to do, and that's what they do. But Tarry is different. Tarry is trying to influence, affect those changes. And Tarry is quite famous these days. And she was on Brian Lehrer's show. Her name is mentioned, one of the most prominent Chinese Americans in New York City, in the latest exhibition in New York Historical Society. What is it? What do we ask you to be? You're the most prominent individual, Chinese American individual.
No, I think it's because I know Cynthia Lee.
Oh, come on now.
They needed someone who was an urban planner.
See, I mean, very modest individual. Huge picture, right. So many people she could have picked, and she picked you. But anyway, so that's our Tarry Hum. And Russell Leong, what can I say about Russell? I knew Russell for, 1986. I taught at UCLA, and he was already the editor of Amerasian Journal. Amerasian Journal is the most authoritative referral magazines for the Asian Americans. He is like the guardian angel for all the things that's qualified, quality to come through the academic. But anyway, so he's worked there for how many years? 33. And knew everything, knew everybody, and seen everything. And but he's interested in New York City. So after he retired, from that job, decided to come to New York,
in part because the Thomas Tan Fellowship. And ever since he's wanting to be here, in a way we're very happy that it's like a foreign aid, that from the West Coast, that we could use some help from him. And he has contributed a great deal. And one of the most distinctive thing he's done is editing as the editor of the CUNY Forum. And in this, even though it's trying to collect articles from the East Coast scholars, but I think the vision is quite ambitious. It's more than just Amerasian Journal. He's trying to be multi-discipline in terms of also introducing art and make it much more exciting. Well, I think it's much more exciting than Amerasian Journal. And so far he has published two, and the third one is coming. And we hope that there will be continual funding for him to go on and establish a journal that really we could really be useful for us, is something that we could be very proud of. Now, he's another one of those guys who's very humble, very, what's the word? Never want to take any credits for anything, but he's very, underneath, very ambitious. He wants to do things. And one of the characteristic is he's deeply involved and influenced by the Buddhist thoughts and his writing and his own living is quite influenced by that. And that's why, you know, I always look at him as my guru. in addition to that, he has spent years getting up 7 o'clock. No. Getting up 6 o'clock so he could go to the park to practice Tai Chi. So anyway, so we will we're very pleased to have his magazines, and I hope that you will all purchase it. Now, so the format after this is that each one, the authors will get a chance to present what they. But they want to summarize some of the work. At the same time, at the end, we will sit down and have some discussions, and you could raise questions on the floor. Thank you.
Thank you to Ari and to Joyce and Russell and Peter and Anthony for the last minute setting up of the equipment here. My apologies for not getting that organized earlier. We're good. Oh, I have a clicker. Fantastic. This is the fourth time over the years that I've been here at AAARI. The first time, as Peter mentioned, has been more about my work with Fujianese immigrants. I think I talked about religion in Chinatown, about East Broadway and employment agencies, and most recently about Fujianese students who have begun to arrive at Baruch College and their educational and immigrant experiences. So I guess I want to say that because the book that I've just published is really an offshoot of all that research. It's my attempt to take my research and my teaching experiences and what I've learned about the world from being an anthropologist and my work in China and in Chinatown, and to try to expand it and the key concepts and key theoretical thinking to a broader audience. So I do actually want to attribute a couple of the key concepts in the book to Peter, who, as my professor over the years, encouraged me to take globalization seriously as I began to research the Fujianese population in Chinatown. The question, I couldn't figure out really why people were coming, and Peter said, well, you better go to Fuzhou and find out. So I did, and that's been part of my research journey. It was 7 or 8 trips now back to Fuzhou, to villages and towns and villages. So to really understand how movement, globalization, interconnection are a part of our world, not just for the global elites, the cosmonauts, but even for working class and working poor undocumented labor immigrants. So globalization and then power. I was doing research on these religious communities, and Peter and I were having lunch one day, and he just said, "Where's the money? Follow the money." which I think was his way of saying, you actually need to start paying attention to the power dynamics in these organizations. It's all well and good to be at worship and at the noodle hour, and but we have to understand what role these communities play and what the power dynamics are within them and how they fit into the larger power structures. So thank you, Peter, for all of that in relationship to this book. I got interested in writing this book because for anthropologists, we do most, my colleagues, I don't know if my you can decide if my research is interesting, but my colleagues do a lot of really interesting research, but it tends to be on very small communities, and it doesn't get a lot of press oftentimes. So I teach cultural anthropology every semester, usually a big class of 100 and some at Baruch College, and what I've learned is that actually intro to cultural anthropology classes are probably anthropology's biggest public audience. So there are almost 200,000 students every year who take an intro to cultural anthropology class. Oftentimes, actually mostly because it's a general education requirement in their undergraduate liberal arts education. So I believe that these intro classes are our greatest opportunities to transform the way Americans think or people think about the crucial issues of our times. It's so much more than having a quote in the New York Times. I actually have a student for 3 hours a week, 15 weeks, and to have that kind of time to really help people think differently about the world is really quite an amazing opportunity. So Baruch is a great place to teach. It's informed my thinking, my pedagogy. We have 70% of our students are immigrants from 100 different countries, lots of different languages, cultures, different notions of culture, race, gender. 80% of them end up being business majors. Cultural anthropology is a general education requirement. They usually come to my class thinking they're going to take a class about rocks, or dinosaurs, maybe astrophysics or something like that. Anthropology is not really in their worldview. So just so we're all clear, anthropology is the study of humans, particularly the many ways that people around the world and throughout history have organized themselves to live in groups. It's a very complicated process, but something we do remarkably well. If you think about 8 million people in New York City, we figured out how to get along pretty well. So that's what we're interested in, how not to live, not humans individually, but humans in community. And the underlying strategy of the book, which is subtitled A Toolkit for a Global Age, is that on a practical level, we're all anthropologists. We all interact with communities, whether it's our family, our scholarly community, our work community, and we're constantly trying to figure out how to fit into a new group of people at a dinner party, when your boyfriend takes you home to meet the family. What are the rules? How do you fit in? So the class that I teach is designed to be a very practical class, to think how do we take the tools of anthropology and apply them to daily life. So let's see if I can make some of these things happen. Oh, they're my students. So these are the folks I look out at every day and try to figure out how to help them think differently about the world, how to see themselves more clearly, live more consciously, and also to develop the tools to engage the world to make it a better place. Because ultimately, I don't think I've met an anthropologist who doesn't do their research in the hope that their research and their writing and will make the world a better place in some way. So I meet with my students and I try to make anthropology relevant. So we talk about a can of Coke. How does it move? What's its social life? Who made it? The women in Plachimata, where the water supply has been severely damaged by the Coca-Cola bottling company. What are the implications of just a can of Coke? That's something that students have every day in front of them. Or a candy bar, right? But most of the chocolate cocoa beans come from West Africa. So it's these teenagers who are making the cocoa beans, are farming them for us and putting them into the system. Or a Happy Meal. I don't know if you've ever really thought about where a Happy Meal comes from. or its implications for the rest of the world. But this is part of the journey that I want my students to begin to take, that they take what's familiar and make it unfamiliar, and take the things that are strange and is that right? Yeah, and make them familiar, right? So sort of reversing, crossing cultural boundaries and living more awake and alive. My students don't want to be lectured to. They want it to be relevant, and they want to think. They want to think more deeply, and so that's what I'm attempting to do with these classes and with the book. I'm trying to honor that request. So, why a toolkit? This is my experience with textbooks. As I began to, I stopped using textbooks quite a few years ago because I couldn't find a cultural anthropology textbook that kind of met my students' needs for contemporary relevance, that helped them see the world today. So this is one of the early cultural anthropology textbooks called Culture, Man, and Nature by Marvin Harris. But you can see the image there and if you saw that on the front of your cultural anthropology textbook, what idea would you take away about cultural anthropology? Primitive, the study of primitives. What else? Yeah. Maybe arcane, not related to us. Anything else? Just two people there in rural areas, isolated. Okay, so this is what I call the textbook as travel guide to the exotic other, someplace over there. So people would take classes, a semester long trip through the textbook to see the curious and fascinating ways other people do things in other places. Some will amaze you, some will gross you out, but probably you'll be relieved by how normal you feel in comparison. I think that was a generation of textbooks. The next generation of textbooks, I don't know, do you see how that's changed? There's some similarities, but some differences. Anybody want to say what they see that's different or the same? Oh, some of it's become very modern. You got a cell phone, but we still have traditional clothes. So we still have the ethnic other out there, but we put her with a cell phone in front of a university. So this is a textbook as travel guide to the exotic other who may be in our midst. This is not the exotic other someplace else, but this is appreciating diversity and difference approach to the anthropology textbooks and trying to understand strange and different people who may have actually come to our schools or our workplaces. So I think this is why a lot of our anthropology classes get listed in the diversity section of a general education curriculum. But today our students don't really need us to take them places. They can go themselves, but they need help navigating where they are and when they get someplace. So the shift that I'm trying to move in with this book is as cultural anthropology as a toolkit for the world to understand it better, so that instead of anthropologists sort of being outside and observing and looking in, this notion that we're all anthropologists, we may not, and that we have a chance to develop those skills more intimately in ways that will help us see the world better. All right, well, how about my textbook cover? How would you? This is hard, right? I picked the cover because I wanted it to tell the story about anthropology and its potential for being a tool to see the world. Any thoughts?
I ask the same question to my students. They all assume this is the world, the building, not a train.
Yeah. This is a train, right? It's the top of a train. I don't know if but here I've tried to show motion rather than people being static. I've tried to show groups rather than individuals. I've tried to show action and vibrancy. I mean, this is.
It does.
It's not a women's only car, but it does have these different components to it. There are some women up there. It's hard. They're more in the background, but yes, there are more women in the. See if I can go back to my original. You can see the overall picture. It's going to take me too long. Sorry, Tarry. My students. Oh, there's the picture. So that's the train car that's on the front of the book. So this is in Bangladesh at a train station as everyone's going home from in Dhaka to go back to for Eid, a Muslim holiday. So I wanted students to see that to start with, so that globalization becomes really clear, the sense of movement, connection, that what we know about humans is we've never been isolated. There have never been isolated groups. We know that from the gene pool. We're all 99.99% identical genetically. We're not isolated. That's just not the way humans work. And humans live in communities. And then this the other piece that I'm really taking on is our culture concept, which has really been thinking of culture as a set of ideas, of meanings, and to push in this notion of power so that we begin to see culture is not just ideas about race, but it's a whole set of institutions that teach us about race and enforce those issues, those notions, and also where those notions are contested. So to give students a sense that culture changes and is negotiated, and that they can be engaged in that change and negotiation themselves. I have to go way back to where I was, but anyway. So I think those are the main things I wanted to talk about in the book. I have another little PowerPoint. I won't show you, but I pulled out a whole lot of the slides because in each of the chapters of the book, I enjoyed bringing some of my own research into the stories. So in the first chapter on anthropology in a global age, I talked about my first experience going to Fuzhou. That's people in a temple in Chinatown had said, when I told them I was going to Fuzhou, they invited me to go back to their temple and to visit. And so I went on the bus from Fuzhou and across the river on a ferry and eventually, you know, on a three-wheeled pedicab and up the mountain. I thought I was a great adventurous anthropologist. And I got to the top of the hill and there was this temple festival going on and the people gathered around and they said, "What are you doing here?" And I said, "Oh, I'm an anthropologist from New York and I've come to learn about religion in Fuzhou." And they all just laughed and they said, "Everybody in the village has left, you know, or wants to leave. You know, go back to New York if you really want to understand what's going on in our village." So, you know, and it was such an, and then we all laughed together because it was kind of ironic. I had come to their village, they wanted to go to my village. But that there was the capacity for us all to understand each other, and actually to really understand each other, you had to see both sides, and you had to see the connections on either side. So, ultimately, I think that our most important task as humans is to train the next generation to think, and analyze, and to engage, so they're prepared to face the challenges of humanity and the planet. I mean, this is what my students ask for. I think it's what they deserve, this relevance, the sense of significance, this tools for analysis. So I hope in some way that my book has provides some avenues into this possibility of living more awake and conscious and engaged in the world. So thank you very much for... I would say I don't have books for sale. But there are some brochures. If you want, you can go to the Norton website, or if you're thinking about using it for a class, please let me know, and I'll get your name and address, and my publisher will reach out to you about getting you an exam copy. So I have a few copies here you can take a look at, though, this evening.
So my name is Tarry Hum, and I am a faculty member at Queens College in the Department of Urban Studies. And my book is, in some ways, autobiographical because my family moved to Sunset Park in 1974, when it was a very, very different kind of neighborhood. But before I kind of get into some of those details, I also want to thank Ari, Joyce, and Russell, and Anthony, and the CUNY Mapping Seminar members, particularly Peter and Russell, for organizing this event and giving me an opportunity to talk about my book. I also want to acknowledge Peter's work and its influence in shaping how I approached my study of Sunset Park. Peter's work, which is very voluminous, but especially his book on the New Chinatown, Forbidden Workers, and multiple nation articles, emphasized the importance of class and class resources and class differences in shaping the Chinese community and their labor market experiences, and also the importance of Chinese workers in U.S. history, U.S. labor history, and in U.S. social movements. Those are really foundational texts that were very, you know, important to me as a graduate student. So my, again, as I noted, my personal narrative is that my parents labored in many of these immigrant niches that Peter has spent his career documenting and really humanizing, you know, the kinds of conditions that exist. My mother worked in the garment industry all of her life, and my father worked in an industrial laundry in Greenpoint, and on weekends he worked in a restaurant. So their home purchase in 1974 in Sunset Park was really a way to find housing to accommodate their very large family. There's four of us, so I'm the oldest, and we were a group of rambunctious kids, and wherever we lived in apartments, people would kind of take the broomstick and they would like hit up on the ceiling because we were all running around. It also included my paternal grandmother. So they scrimped and saved and took out a mortgage, and they bought a house in Sunset Park on 8th Avenue and 55th Street, which is now the heart of you know, Sunset Park's Chinese community. But at that time, you know, a lot of the storefronts along 8th Avenue, you know, either they catered to the Norwegian community, or, you know, they were like kind of not exactly boarded up, but they were kind of marginal businesses, like on the corner where the Pacificana restaurant is, was a refrigeration repair shop. So 8th Avenue was really, you know, very quiet, not quite as disinvested some of the other parts of the city, because remember, my family moved to Sunset Park in 1974 when it was almost the height of the New York City fiscal crisis. And I think that in large part, my parents were able to purchase into that house. They were one of the very few Chinese families, because there was very little organized resistance to, you know, Chinese immigrants. Our neighbors on the one side was the D'Amiglios, an Italian family, and the other side was the Walshes. And we basically, over the years, watched people, you know, leaving because the Chinese were coming. So, there was a book that was written on Sunset Park. It was published, I think, in the early 90s, and it was written by a man named Lewis Winnick, who was a program officer at the Ford Foundation. And it was published by the Russell Sage Foundation, the book. And it was called New Immigrants in Old Neighborhoods. And of course, you know, being from Sunset Park, I took a great interest in reading the book. And it does provide a really interesting kind of history of housing and the development of Sunset Park, and also noted the growing Latino population, which, as Peter noted, you know, earlier at that time in the 70s was largely Puerto Rican. They're not an immigrant group. You know, Puerto Ricans are U.S. citizens. But, you know, these were Puerto Rican families that had moved to Sunset Park because of urban renewal and displacement from their neighborhoods in Manhattan. And then also noted the growing population of Chinese immigrants. And the way that Lewis Winnick framed this book was to kind of contrast the experience of a Latino underclass who was mired in poverty and lack of opportunity, contrasting it with an entrepreneurial immigrant minority who was clearly kind of starting up small businesses. So really casting the population of Sunset Park as a deserving poor and an undeserving poor. An undeserving poor that was increasingly jobless because of the economic changes in that neighborhood. And then the deserving poor that came and, you know, were excluded from opportunities but kind of put together resources to start small businesses and whatnot. I fundamentally disagreed with that kind of framing of the different populations that made up the community of Sunset Park. So Peter's work kind of, I think that I extended that kind of urban political economic framework to understand community studies, my approach to community studies, and to understand what was going on in Sunset Park. And I think that my title, you know, Making a Global Immigrant Neighborhood, is a reference to kind of that framework. And the framework is really kind of focused on what Ken has been describing, and that is the process of globalization, of economic globalization in particular. And, you know, in the United States, that economic globalization resulted, you know, in a massive deindustrialization, which, you know, Chinese and Latino women in the garment industry, you know, helped to hang on to a downgraded industry for, you know, a couple of decades, but also kind of resulted in a very bifurcated, you know, service sector, a very kind of high skill, high knowledge, as well as a massive low skill, you know, a service base of workers, including food services and other services. So that's one part of this kind of globalization framework. The other, of course, is the fact that Sunset Park is incredibly diverse. You know, New York City is an immigrant city, but in terms of its post-1965 immigration, one thing that I know Joe Saville also always notes is how incredibly diverse immigration is to New York, unlike other cities, other gateway cities like Los Angeles, where the majority of immigrants are Mexicans. That's not the case in New York. New York is very, very diverse. But I think that in one of his talks, he also noted that the Chinese are about to eclipse the Dominicans as the largest immigrant group in New York City. And the diversity is not only in terms of a racial or national origin composition, but also has to do with class. You know, post-1965 immigrants were not all laborers. Many of them came with class resources, and that certainly affected, you know, their trajectory of being incorporated into the U.S. political economy. And then the third aspect of this globalization framework is, of course, neoliberal urban policies. And, you know, well, Bloomberg, it kind of epitomizes that kind of holding up the market as a solution, or the private sector as solutions to kind of public issues and public problems. So that's the framework that I use, that I think is very different from Winnick's, you know, which is kind of focusing on the so-called cultural differences or not, you know, or between these different populations in Sunset Park, but looking at the very fundamental structural changes that were happening in our economy that created kind of marginal opportunities for some immigrant groups and then heightened hardships, you know, for other groups. My chapters in the book, to borrow the terminology of kind of environmental justice activists, each of the chapters really, you know, show how I think that Sunset Park is kind of a frontline community on issues of social justice and equity. And I'm just going to take a swig. And I think the three things that I want to highlight are a frontline community on addressing gentrification, a frontline issue on the issues of economic inequality, and especially given de Blasio's mandate, you know, of addressing the Tale of Two Cities, I think that Sunset Park is really an important place where, you know, many of the policies and whatnot would be tested. And I'll go into an example. And then a frontline community and the importance of kind of doing multiracial community building because, you know, our neighborhoods, our immigrant neighborhoods are very diverse. Okay, so the question of gentrification is really important in Sunset Park as it is in many immigrant neighborhoods, including Manhattan, Chinatown. And I think I see two kinds of gentrification trajectories that are happening. One is the kind that looks like it's gentrification, kind of the hipster-driven gentrification. I actually read in the Wall Street Journal these two young developers in Dumbo who were talking about creating this incubator for high tech. And they described the processes as that they wanted to create a hipster kibbutz. You know, kind of this place where everybody kind of work collectively, but it's all kind of very, you know, tied to creative industries and to high tech and whatnot. That's happening in Sunset Park. It's happening along Sunset Park's waterfront. One thing that may not be as widely known about Sunset Park is that it has a 2-mile, you know, waterfront, that includes Bush Terminal, which at the time was one of the largest kind of industrial parks that has its own railroad tracks that kind of service the various, you know, factory buildings. It also has the Brooklyn Army Terminal, which Mayor de Blasio has recently committed $100 million to renovate to accommodate light manufacturing. And it also has the federal warehouse building that was recently purchased and is now called Liberty View Plaza. That's going to have like the largest, I think the world's largest rooftop garden. It's going to have a hydroponic garden that will grow lettuce and tomatoes and whatnot. So part of Sunset's past has been that it's always been a very working class, you know, industrial community. The community prides itself as, you know, a walk to work neighborhood. They often cite the census statistics that show high percentages of people that live in Sunset Park walk to, you know, their place of work along the waterfront. The waterfront now, I don't know of how many of you kind of been reading the New York Times, but the Industry City, which is a cluster of buildings that was once Bush Terminal, is now being headed up by Andrew Kimball, who was the director of the Brooklyn Navy Yard. And Brooklyn Navy Yard is an example of kind of, you know, what kind of manufacturing is still viable in New York City, which tends to be very high value added, you know, artisanal crafts. So Andrew Kimball is now, the cluster of buildings was purchased, I think 51% ownership by Jamestown Properties. Andrew Kimball is the director of global innovations and the CEO of Industry City for Jamestown. And he has basically, you know, talked about how Industry City is now a site for makers and innovators. And if you look in the New York Times, Industry City, the courtyards, they have parties. They're called Mr. Sunday parties. You pay $10. You have access to beer. And the photographs are quite striking because all the hipsters are there and they're dancing and, you know, along the Sunset Park waterfront. That's a hipster-driven gentrification. That's definitely happening in Sunset Park. And I remember they interviewed Jacques Torres, who opened up a factory along the Sunset Park waterfront. And he was interviewed saying, you know, what does he feel about his new factory in Sunset Park? He goes, you know, this is not a bad neighborhood. You can come here and not get shot. So that's kind of the image, you know, Sunset Park, dangerous, you know, full of immigrants, Latinos, Puerto Ricans, undocumented Mexicans and Chinese, et cetera. there's another kind of gentrification which Peter alluded to earlier, which is gentrification that is kind of more of an intra-ethnic gentrification, I call it, because it's being underwritten by ethnic banks. It's being written by both kind of locally U.S. established Chinese banks, as well as increasing presence of transnational banks. So they're building market rate luxury condominiums. They have no care, you know, who lives there. But, you know, it could be for the Chinese community, but it could be also, you know, for people that are being priced out of Park Slope, which is a neighborhood to the north. And in fact, you know, there's been examples of these new developments being right in Sunset Park, but being marketed as being in Bay Ridge, you know, which is another neighborhood that is more affluent and probably more desirable. So actually, that's kind of an area of future research for me, because I really want to understand the different scales and the different forms of transnational capital, because the four largest state-owned banks in China, which also happen to be the four among the 10 largest banks in the world, with the Industrial and Commercial Bank of China being the largest, they all have offices in these immigrant Asian neighborhoods, Flushing, Sunset Park, and in Manhattan, Chinatown. The issue of economic inequality, you know, Sunset Park, I had this conversation with Catherine Wild, and Catherine Wild actually had her start, believe it or not. Well, I should explain who she is. She is the president CEO of the Partnership for the City of New York. So she is a very important person in terms of representing all of the city's Fortune 500 companies and their interests in urban policy and in urban affairs and in maintaining New York City as a positive, welcoming environment for their businesses. She started out as a community organizer in Sunset Park, and she lives not too far away. You know, her observation, why did I bring her up? In terms of economic inequality. Oh yes, her observation when I've talked to her about the fact that Sunset Park is among neighborhoods that have very, very high poverty rates. The poverty rate for Asians in Sunset Park is 30%, which is way higher than the city average. And her comment is that, you know, it doesn't, you know, working poverty, you know, that's just kind of a consequence of kind of first generation immigrant experiences. Sunset Park is vibrant. It has a very active, you know, vibrant economy, and therefore it's really an example of, you know, what is working and what is well. But there is tremendous inequality, and I think that the question of the fact that the mayor introduced his jobs task force for New Yorkers in Sunset Park in front of the Brooklyn Army Terminal, you know, raises the question of how are our immigrant workers going to be kind of included in this new creative, innovative economy that is being promoted by the city along the waterfront and generally. And then the final thing is the importance of multiracial community building. I mean, I know that Sunset Park is often referred to as a satellite Chinatown, but all of the kind of the jurisdictions that kind of, you know, the political jurisdictions, the community board boundary jurisdictions, all of the jurisdictions of Sunset Park includes a fairly, you know, large majority Latino population, no longer Puerto Rican for sure. And even the Dominicans are, I think Mexicans are the fastest growing sector in the among the Latino population. But it is, and there's also a growing Ecuadorian population, whereas the Asian population in Sunset Park is majority Chinese, even though there is a small South Asian Pakistani community. And then of course Sunset Park also has a Palestinian population as well. So I was talking in the course of this research, I was talking to a community, a Chinese woman, lovely Chinese woman who has a son and a husband and living in Sunset Park, looking to buy a house but finding it increasingly impossible because she was telling me that all the transactions are in cash. People are coming in with cash and just purchasing these homes. And that is an issue in Sunset Park because property ownership patterns are moving more towards investors. And you can see it because they're being purchased by limited liability corporations and not individuals. But in any case, she said to me, you know, the future of this neighborhood is Mexican and Chinese. I couldn't have said it better, so I quoted her, but because I really do believe that the future of Sunset Park is Mexican and Chinese. Sunset Park elected the first Mexican American to serve on the New York City Council, and that's Carlos Menchaca. So I know that the process, and I also wanted to give this one example about there are lots of different organizations that are being formed in Sunset Park, and one of them is called the Brooklyn Community Improvement Association. They're part of this immigrant growth coalition because they're largely comprised of realtors who really want to project a more positive image of Sunset Park in order to kind of attract people to come and purchase these market rate, you know, luxury condominiums that are being built. But in any case, she made the point to tell me, because I think I slipped and I said Brooklyn Chinese Improvement. She said, "No, this community is not just a Chinese community. It's a multiracial community, and we deliberately use that word community to recognize that this is a neighborhood that is made up of all kind of different groups." So, in the book, I look at that really the possibilities and the hope for building community among this multiracial working class neighborhood really rests on like community leaders that have a vision of Sunset Park that is inclusive of everybody that lives in that neighborhood and cares about that neighborhood, but also increasingly on the youth. Because it's the young people that have the language ability and that also interact with each other in all of these different spaces in the neighborhood, in, you know, from the parks to the schools, etc. And it's affirming to know that there are community organizations and leaders that really are working on promoting this kind of multiracial youth alliances around issues of environmental justice, around kind of shared issues of community concern. Police brutality was one of them. There's been several incidences, and there was a rally, and it was great to see that the Chinese community showed up, you know, to support the Latino community. So I think I will end it at that, and we can hopefully have conversation.
Yeah. I'm going to make mine short. Let me just take a survey. How many of you have use a GPS on your car or cell phone? You all use a GPS, right? You use it every day? But how many of you use a GPS to look at Asian Americans? Is there such a thing? No, no such thing. That's why we created the CUNY Forum. Actually, the two issues here, and a lot of our authors are actually here. And the CUNY Forum is basically not only to talk about Asian American studies, but also about Asian Americans and Asia. So we have quite a task. Actually, since the authors are here, and I would like to just point them out, so in case you do buy a copy, you can actually ask them to sign or something. Susan Wong, sitting back there, wrote about students at Baruch and her role in mentoring them. Susan. John Chin wrote about churches and HIV education in the Asian American community. It's very important because HIV is one of these global diseases, along with the latest one, Ebola. And I think Asian Americans, you know, basically need to educate ourselves about that as well. Professor Peter Kwong wrote a very moving personal essay about his relationship with the Dalai Lama and his journey from being a student in Taiwan as a fervent, I don't know whether you were a fervent Christian, but anyway, from a Christian in the choir to basically embracing another way of living. Tarry, who just spoke, wrote about Sunset Park, and Ken Guess.
No, about Flushing.
Flushing.
And
oh yeah, your students, and that's in this first issue, and Ken wrote about Fujianese students. In our second issue, our current issue, is Tomia here? Tomia, right? She has a very beautiful portfolio of etchings from the World War II internment, in which she used her own family as part of the figures and part of the subject matter integrated into the motifs, and you could see it right here. As I said, the purpose of CUNY Forum is basically sort of like an intellectual GPS to Asian America. And let me just pass out this kind of a mapping. It's kind of like school, but I know you're not in school. But anyway, if you just open up, you see this kind of a map, and it sort of follows along what Ken Guest was talking about earlier, sort of a kind of a cultural toolkit. And this map sort of asks questions and makes kind of tries to connect the dots in terms of Asian Americans and bigger issues. For instance, we have two essays on Asian Americans and the legacy of Nelson Mandela. And at first you might say, well, what's the relationship between Asian Americans and Nelson Mandela and South Africa? Well, it so happens that the two people who wrote, one is a Korean American who lived with her Afro-American husband in South Africa for 15 years. And she heads the Chinese Research Institute in Johannesburg. And she wrote about her experience being a Korean American in South Africa, and her daughter was actually born there. And interestingly enough, when she lived in South Africa, she was considered white, probably because of her professional status, and she was a Korean. On the other hand, another essay written by a Filipino American man, basically, who was also educated in South Africa. He said that in the apartheid days, he would be considered black. So why would a Korean woman be considered white and a Filipino American man be considered black? You'll have to actually buy a copy and find out for yourself.
Or you can read
you can also read Ken's race chapter. So this is what I mean by the CUNY Forum is sort of like we're trying to create kind of an intellectual GPS, kind of a map for Asian America and Asia. And our kind of theme and our thrust is basically this, global voices, local identity. No, excuse me, it's the other way around. Global identities and local voices. All three of our speakers today, Ken, Tarry, and Peter, obviously, they have a global approach, a transnational approach to looking at immigrant groups, to looking at communities, even to looking at gentrification, banking, investment, labor. However, they are local voices because they're right here in front of you. So we're really lucky to actually have them tonight. And so that's really the theme. And one of the important things is that, you know, I come from the generation in which I'm not too literate, and images and meant a lot more to me. So we focus also on the visuals. So when you look at this image here, where is it? Does anybody know? This flag hanging on this building? Yeah, it's in Chinatown. How can you tell it's in Chinatown? If you look at the window very closely, it has a little sign that says 24-hour massage, whatever. So hey, you know it's Chinatown. No, I mean if you actually have to study the cover. It's actually taken by Anthony Wong, actually. And so if you buy an issue, you get to really look at it really carefully. And then you know, this also links you to John Chin's study, a new study of sort of the Asian massage industry, right, in Los Angeles and the East Coast area. So there's many, many links on this GPS that might not be apparent at first glance. Now, this second issue here, you know, this is just a pitch, but this is a you can't see it too clearly. It's a performance artist, Cambodian American. She has a sort of a orange-colored, saffron-colored hijab, sort of a traditional Muslim clothing, but the color is a little bit different. It's actually saffron, like Buddhist. Now, she is a Cambodian American from Chicago. She's now living and doing performances in Phnom Penh in Cambodia, but she's a kind of a closet Buddhist, even though she was born and raised Muslim. So she's trying to reconcile her Muslim and Buddhist identities. And she has some poems and also a description of her kind of journey in this issue for only $10. And so as you could see, GPS will take you to places that you never thought you would be traveling to before. But it's all pretty safe. You'll learn something. And hopefully we can all work together on this kind of intellectual mapping. And I too am indebted to Peter Kwong and to the members of the mapping group. And that's why I borrowed their idea and decided rather than writing a long introduction to create this map. So for instance, if you look at Tomia Rai's etchings in the back, you'll say, well, what are these, just interesting pictures? No, you actually have to read her description about the interment and about, it was actually based on Momotaro, a Japanese sort of folktale about a boy kind of emerging from the peach, I believe. And so there's all these links. And so basically, I have a selfish purpose. I want to learn myself. And my job, I'm not a scholar. I'm kind of like the UPS man of Asian American studies. I hope to deliver the boxes. And then you open them, and then there's stuff inside, right? And then, you know, you're happy. So our job is to make you happy, deliver the GPS, take you places, and for a very low price. Thank you.
Could you identify yourself?
Yeah, I'm Sai Leong from the State University of New York, Albany. So actually, I'm staying the whole year in New York City at Urban Foundation. I think first, when you talk about Mexican, right, when I look at these 2010 census, amazingly, Mexican don't go to California, actually Mexican go to New York. So I think one of the places they go probably is the park, right? So on the ground, do you see that happening in the neighborhood, in Mexican offices, shops, and so forth?
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
That's maybe I can finish my second question, and then you can answer. And then on the first part of your story about the, initially Puerto Rican community, is on the part, and then Chinese community. So initially, were there any conflict between Puerto Ricans and the Chinese who moved in? Where are the Puerto Ricans now? Did they move out? Did they stay there?
That's a great question. Okay. So absolutely, the Mexican community is growing in Sunset Park, and there are community kind of organizations and leaders that are also forming in the neighborhood to kind of work with the Mexican community. I think, and their great growth was fairly recent, I would say. Was fairly recent because for a long time the Latino population in Sunset Park was predominantly Puerto Rican and Dominican. But I would say like within the last 10 or 15 years, it's taken off. And you absolutely do see the changes in terms of the storefronts along Fifth Avenue in Sunset Park. There are two major commercial areas. You know, 8th Avenue tends to cater and anchor the Chinese community. And then 5th Avenue is where the Latino businesses are. And where the Latino community has really concentrated has been more from the waterfront up to, about 6th or 7th Avenue. But with the growing numbers of the Chinese, they have been increasingly moving down toward the waterfront. They have been expanding the boundaries of Sunset Park from, I mean, the Chinese section used to be concentrated between 60th Street and maybe 50th or 55 where my dad is. It is now going all the way down to 39th Street in terms of the presence of small commercial businesses as well as housing. And then it is going down further south. It's kind of that spine that connects Diker Heights. When you go down 8th Avenue towards like the 60s into the 70s, it's Diker Heights, and then it moves, starts to move into Bensonhurst. And in fact, there has been some discussions among some of the community leaders to erect a arch as kind of a form of placemaking for a little Fuzhou on 8th Avenue and 62nd Street. Mm-hmm. Now, this has been, it's been presented as a gift from a certain village in China, but what I heard of late is that DOT and the other city agencies are a little sensitive about Chinese money, so they're not quite sure whether they want to accept this arch or not, but certainly the growth of the community, and it is, it's majority, I think, Fuzhou at this point. When my family moved in the 70s, it was really Toysonese, but now it's largely Fuzhou, and it's all over. So the relationship, I think that in the earlier years, because there was some physical separation, because the Chinese were largely up around 8th Avenue, and the Puerto Ricans were down closer to the waterfront, there wasn't that much opportunity for exchange. But increasingly there are, and some of the tensions really have to do with the fact that Chinese landlords don't want to rent to Latinos. And so when a Chinese landlord kind of purchases a building, they will then proceed to kind of evict or harass or, you know, to empty out their housing of Latino tenants. There has been in the past, you know, various efforts, you know, to kind of build common understanding by having different forums and stuff happen. There's been like efforts like the Sunset United, which would bring different kind of community leaders together. They're episodic, you know, in terms of bringing leaders of Asian and Latino communities together, but they happen fairly often. And there's been some community leaders like Cheng She, who was the branch director of the Chinese American Planning Council satellite office in Sunset Park, that worked very actively with Elizabeth Yuan Pear, who is a Puerto Rican civil rights lawyer and an environmental justice leader, and heads up a group called UPROSE, which is like the oldest Puerto Rican service organization in Sunset Park. They've worked on issues of public health, because Sunset Park has the Gowanus Expressway that, you know, is a multi-lane, you know, highway that spews, you know, pollution. They also have that underneath the Gowanus Expressway is like an 8-lane darkened street in which crossing is a people risk their lives. Like they risk their lives crossing Queens Boulevard, they risk their lives crossing the Gowanus Expressway. So, you know, around issues of common concern with respect to health, public health and stuff, with respect to youth leadership, with respect to addressing the issues of gentrification, there have been examples of Chinese and Latino community leaders coming together to work on those issues.
Tarry, I want to ask you a question. So I'm writing something about gentrification, and
usually, it's about gentrification.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And usually the person who's the gentrifier, right? If I may identify as like a white person, right?
Yeah.
And in all the articles, usually gets obfuscated. And I want to know who is the gentrifier in like in Flushing or in the Sunset Park area? Like, is there like a direct,
yeah,
or is it the realtor, right?
Right.
Can we trace something?
Yeah. I mean, the definition of gentrification is that it's a class upgrading of the neighborhood, right? It's a changing of the class composition of the neighborhood. It doesn't really make reference necessarily to race because it's about class.
Right.
But typically, gentrifiers, you know, the ones that have more resources, tend to be also white. In Sunset Park, you see, as I said, you see that kind of gentrification happening. You certainly do. You see more white hipsters, you know, in the markets, you know, especially in the Finnish co-ops that are near Sunset Park. They're being marketed, you know, to people that are looking for, you know, a certain kind of quality of life, a certain aesthetic in terms of an apartment, but can't afford it in Park Slope or can't afford it in Brooklyn Heights. But then you also have the gentrifiers, you know, who are part of the kind of the immigrant, what I call an immigrant growth coalition. Right. They're the architects, they're the developers, they're the investors, and they're driving property values, and they're making it difficult for, you know, a working class families to have a decent, you know, home in that neighborhood. And that is also, my book starts off with a protest of Chinese and Latino, you know, immigrants coming together to fight the rezoning of Sunset Park, which was going to permit these kind of, you know, projects to happen. So it's not necessarily just the hipster, it's also this kind of immigrant growth coalition and the presence of banks and the presence of investors. And in my book, I do document examples of like investors kind of purchasing a home, because much of Sunset Park is an R6 zone, which is a fairly permissive zone. And they don't live in the neighborhood, and they purchase it, and they're an LLC. And then they immediately, you know, redevelop the house, and they, you know, have condominiums, build condos. So.
My name is Edward
Long.
I'm a psychotherapist. I'm trained as a psychiatric social worker. And Harry just mentioned he bought the house in 1974.
Yes, my father did. Yes.
This crisis.
Yes.
I was very, very puzzled by a saw in Chinatown, a sign, "We don't move company." I was struck by the "we don't move," because that time a lot of Chinese people were drug, because of the financial crisis, a lot of people moving out of Chinatown. But the Chinese always stay. So I'm saying it's a global, you know, when you think global, work on local. I'm so glad you work on the Sunset Park, you work on the Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
And Peter, of course, has constantly provide leadership intellectually, labor, integration, many things in this field. I'm glad to see today really a maturation process of academic and conceptualize the whole process multicultural improvement of globalization, you know, in the prosperity in the physical process. I'm glad, I especially appreciate Henry provide such a forum, you know, to discuss, to present, really make Asian Americans able to establish authority in this regard, especially Russell mentioned the two, you know, CUNYs, two elbows. And it's a very, very interesting, and especially King, I saw you before, you were invited to join the mayor, Fuji mayor, you know, established many developmental supermarkets or something. I was very impressed, you know, you were able to penetrate, you know, inside of the culture, you know, the ingredients. That's very hard. Even Chinese couldn't get that through. And so I'm so glad, and you know, tonight is such a really, it's a really celebration of a successful, you know, the academic and the dynamic, you know, practical, you know, multi, I don't know how to say it, maturation, you know, conceptualize the multicultural immigration labor project. Also, I have to say, I have to not check upon the Chinese, give up, you know, and Anthony and me working on the Chinatown working group, we are ferociously Chinatown, this is not Chinese. There are plenty of foreigners, Western and my colleagues that, why don't you say Chinatown in the neighborhood? Because this is not China. Chinatown is just Chinese. No, it's a whole multi-group. You just said it's not, you know, not, you know, the conflict. actually it's an interactional process. Mm-hmm. During the process, always conflict. The conflict is a property. And the psychological in group process is a property. You have to fight. Most of the Chinese always, we don't fight, we never know each other. Mm-hmm. So you always actually, you have to fight, you speak mm-hmm. up, you argue, then you integrate it. Same
right.
thing with the software part with Dickens, you know, the grocery store,
uh-huh.
black, you know.
Right.
So I feel like I'm glad to be, I'm so glad I can say, think global, working local.
Right.
So you work your software part with the Portuguese, able to prove, you know, your theories.
Right.
Thank
you.
Let's go.
Okay, one more.
I would like to ask, besides of the physical transformation of the sunset park, would you like to say a little bit about the adjustment of the younger generation to Jenny's kids happen and the adjustment happen and the how they adjust themselves and proceed for their future in the neighborhood and also in school.
Right.
Because I think they are the one who is going to change the face of something.
Right. Right. Do you,
sure.
that, yeah, good.
Because you start.
That's a,
you start.
Well, I mean, this book, it, I think there were, the, in the process of writing this book, it became apparent to me what more I needed to know and what more I needed to learn to really understand this community and to be, you know, to be able to be an effective stakeholder in this community. I have to say that my experience with dealing with issues of youth has primarily been through talking with various youth directors of programs in Sunset Park. I mentioned the Chinese American Planning Council. I mentioned UpRose. Actually, our former city council member, Sarah Gonzalez, also had a group called HIPA, which was Hispanic Young People's Association. Again, I think that because I'm a urban planner, you know, much of my work was really kind of focused on kind of planning issues and on economic development and land and property ownership and other things, and more the political economy of the neighborhood. So that's a really, you're right, I think that they are the future and they're going to shape the dynamics, the future dynamics of the neighborhood. But maybe I'll turn it over to Kang, who has more expertise, you know, in the Fujianese community than I do.
Well,
I've worked with young people.
I would just
right.
point you to the article that my colleague at Baruch and I, Ke Leong, did in the first CUNY Forum. We did a study of, when I started teaching at Baruch 13 years ago, I never found any Fujianese in my classes. But now I find many. And so we've completed a study of about 100 of the students, Fujianese students at Baruch, and examined their immigrant experiences and their educational experiences. So just a couple of thoughts. Obviously, some are, there are multiple groups there. So some are born here and grow up here. Some are born here and have been sent home. And then they come back here when they're 5 to go to school. And then there's a large group, maybe 30-35% or so of the folks that we studied were coming in high school. So their parents were already here, and then their parents were bringing them as freshmen, sophomores, and juniors even in high school too. So, and then they were moving into dual language programs in public high schools in New York. So they were drawing on some community resources that are already in place in terms of the test prep institutions that were in place for the Cantonese and others long before the Fujianese arrived. So they've been using those, and then they've been very strategic about preparing for the SATs, which, as we know, in most of the community, in most of the CUNY colleges, that's the sole criteria for admission. So to be able to maximize your math score allows you to have a lower English score and still get into one of the senior mm-hmm. colleges. So we were finding students coming to Baruch who had really only had 2 or 3 years of high school in the U.S. And were now struggling to work in the university setting. So part of the complication is that their families are very transient. And so while many of them, most of them reported living with both parents, when we began to survey them and actually hold focus groups and interviews with them, it turned out that rarely were both parents at home. Their mom was at home, but their dad was part of the family, but he was constantly on the road through the employment agency, bus networks, working in restaurants all across the East Coast or even Midwest. So he was coming in. And sometimes the moms were too, and they were living with extended families. So Susan Wong actually works so much with these students in the Sikh program at Baruch, and could probably say more about that as well. But so that's part of their context. And we found that they were being very strategic about their studies and doing quite well at Baruch, but we have an anxiety that they're using a strategic adaptation in their studies, which is sort of relying on one another in the Fujianese community and a fairly narrow circle of friends to get through their classes. And they're maybe more heavily at Baruch because it's a business school, and so more of the classes are quantitative. And allow them to use their quantitative skills to succeed. But what we're beginning now to do is to follow up with folks after they graduate, because our concern is that once they move into the workforce, that they will have graduated with a good GPA at Baruch, but they wouldn't necessarily have mastered the English language skills that would allow them to maximize their opportunities in the future. So I think these are just some thoughts about
Yeah, I think I would like to add another dimension to this discussion. About a year ago, I have a student who's a police captain. She actually worked at Sunset Park for many, many years. And she called me up. She says, "Did you read the Chinese newspaper?" I said, "Well, yeah, what about?" She says, "Three kids disappeared in Sunset Park, and they the police, family, everybody's looked for them. In fact, they even use helicopters try to locate these kids. And finally, after 3 days, they located these two kids. Finally, walk home to the parents. And so, what happened is basically exactly the family structure is not what we conceived. In other words, the father is never home." Working somewhere else. So the mother is in charge. At the same time, the mother is also working. And so the kids pretty much left to their own device. And what happened was they got a report card. And the report card is very, very bad. So the three kids afraid they're going to get beaten up by the father coming home. So they just disappeared. And they stay in the park for 3 days and finally got too hungry and came back. So what I'm trying to say is that there's a whole dimension about these immigrant families that's not typical. You know, you talk about Chinese close family structure and whatever. In some of these Fujianese families, they're not. You have tremendous disadvantage in that way. And in addition to that, you know, I've been working on Fujianese kids for so long that just tell you a story. I have another student who worked for social work in Chinatown. And she came to me after 3 or 4 years, she said, "I'm really pissed off about this job. I'm really sad. I don't like this group of people I'm working with." I said, "What are you talking about?" She says, "This is the Fujianese." I said, "Why are you not happy with them?" She says, "Well, she works in this clinic, childbirth, what is it called? The services?
Children's services.
As illegals, you don't get any kind of welfare, social welfare. But if you have a baby, right? Questions is not going to be asked. So you could actually go to this clinic to say, I'm going to have a baby.
Prenatal
care, right? Prenatal and postnatal care. So she says, well, you know, I work here, and they would tell me, you know, I don't want to get married, but I have to get married. All right? So she says, well, you know, you don't want to get married, but you want to get married for what? Well, some kind of status, right? So what happened is, as soon as they get married, they have kids. The kids become kind of insurance, right? If you're illegal, now you have a kid that's American citizen, clearly, you know, there will be, when you get caught, there's going to be some kind of consideration. So they always get married, have kids, right? They don't necessarily want to get married. But then when they have kids, he says, you know what? They send them back to China. Why? Because they're too busy. The two parents working all the time. That's exactly what you're talking about. So send the kids back to Fuzhou and spoiled by the grandparents. And then by the time, you know, 8 years or sometimes even later, send them back, right? So they come back. They don't want to come back. Now the kids don't want to be here, because they're totally unprepared, language, school is don't know how to deal with them. So for a very, very long,
they
don't know their parents. So for a long time, this is a very, very serious kind of issues. And this is kind of a, you know, I mean, when you go into the detailed studies about immigrant community, working class immigrant community, these are the issues that's really quite important, right? So, but going back to about this SATs, did you read the latest survey in terms of SAT score versus family income? Have you ever seen it?
Yeah.
It's absolutely the same. There is not a in other words, from 20,000 to 200,000, and it's always going up. So again, this is what Vivian Louie has been doing about the class resources, the education, the kind of future. So these are the issues that we encountering, and it's a real challenge to education institutions.
I'm going to add to what Ken had just said about the students, which is something that I don't know if you're aware of or not, but because I work with students and they talk to me, one of the reasons why they do so well in SAT, especially in the math, is because while they're in high school, the high school college counselors encourage them to take the SAT prep courses, and they are free. And they said, this is the strategy. If you want to go to a four-year college, this is what you have to do. Go to the SAT prep courses and bring your SAT score back, bring it up to standards so that you could be admitted. And I know from my experience talking to some of my colleagues, they resent that. They said, that's not fair. They cheated. They really shouldn't be here. So this is a lot of prejudice going on in the system. So, and when we talk about the family structure, it's true that often on paper it's that, because we do a survey when they come in, both parents live in the household, but when I sit down with them as an individual, I said, so what does your father do and where does he work? Oh, actually he's not home. He's working in Connecticut. I said, so you're really living with just your mom, right? You know, so you have to go through all that. Sometimes they're here by themselves. The parents are not here. Drop them off and they're gone. So I have students that come to me and say, you know, Susan, I have to move. I said, why? I'm living with my aunt and she really doesn't like me. I said, where are you going to go? So we have that kind of conversation. So you don't know their family structure until you start building that relationship and they're comfortable enough to come and talk to you. Another aspect is that our students feel a lot of pressure from their family because they know they're here and they're supposed to be getting a good education and they're supposed to get good grades. So yes, it's more than just a report card at the college level, and especially at Baruch, the accounting major, if you're not the top 60% in that class, you're not going to get A or B, and you need to have at least a 2.25 in order to get into the school of Ziegler for business major. That's a lot of pressure. We have students that committed suicide because they knew they weren't going to get an A. Okay, and I had to talk to the father after they died. Or the parents. So, yes, it's a very complex issue that we're dealing with.
So okay. Yeah, thank you, Susan. And actually, you can read more about what she does in the first issue of the CUNY Forum. So now we're going to basically let the authors and you free, and you can buy some of their books. They'll be stay around.
Right.
So you can sign them.
Sure.
And we'd like to, on behalf of Ari and on behalf of the mapping group, And thank you, Peter, Professor Peter Kwong, again. Please enjoy the rest of the evening and help yourself. Thank you.